Coming now to section 7, which is analysis of the income statement. Broadly speaking, there are two ways to analyze the income statement, and both these methods are actually related. One is to look at a common sized income statement. The other is to look at ratios. With a common sized income statement, every item on the income statement is taken as a percentage of sales or net sales. Here we are looking at every item as a percentage of net sales. In 2011, the company had net sales of 1 million. So 1 million as a percentage of 1 million is 100%. Cost of goods sold is 500,000. This is 50% of the net sales, and so on. The advantage of doing a common sized income statement is that you can look at every item and see that item as a percentage of sales. Then if you do a time series analysis of the company, look at how numbers are changing over time. Notice that cost of goods sold went from 50% of net sales to 58.5%. So this means that cost of goods sold is actually increasing quite a lot. Perhaps suppliers increased their cost. Looking at the percentages is much more meaningful than looking at the absolute increase in cost of goods sold, because it is quite possible that the net sales goes up by so much that cost of goods sold goes up in absolute terms, but in percentage terms it doesn't go up that much, or in percentage terms it might also go down. But looking at the common size statement gives you a clearer picture of what's happening relative to revenue. This is a time series analysis. If you look at the curriculum also shows a cross-sectional analysis where you can compare numbers for different companies over the same time period. But again, the main point to remember is that with a common sized income statement, all numbers are expressed as a percentage of sales. Some of the most important ratios that you can extract from the income statement are gross profit margin, operating profit margin, and net profit margin. Gross profit margin is equal to the gross profit divided by sales. And notice that that number is also given in the common sized income statement. Gross profit divided by sales is 50% over here. Gross profit divided by sales for 2012 is 41.5. So it looks like the gross profit is going down, which makes sense given that the cost of goods sold is going up. The operating profit margin is essentially the operating profit, or EBIT, divided by sales. In this particular case, the operating profit margin is 17% in 2011 and down to 7.6% in 2012. So that also is a negative trend. Net profit margin is the net income divided by net sales, and notice that that number is going down also. Comprehensive income. Here is a topic that we'll cover in this reading on the income statement, and then when you see this item in the next reading on the balance sheet, it will make more sense. Comprehensive income is equal to net income plus other comprehensive income. Net income is what you show on the income statement. It's the revenue minus expenses, which are reported on the income statement. And then there are other revenue and expense items which are excluded from the net income calculation. That impact is captured in something called other comprehensive income, which is a part of equity. But at this stage, you simply need to memorize a few core points, and over the next few slides, these points will make more sense. And when you do the reading on balance sheet, it will make even more sense. There are four types of items that are treated as other comprehensive income. Unrealized gains, losses from a certain category of investment security called AFS is treated as other comprehensive income. This means that if the value of an AFS security goes up, that is a gain, but this gain is not shown in the income statement. It is shown in the equity segment of the balance sheet as other comprehensive income. We will see this in detail in the next reading on the balance sheet. Then these other items you just need to memorize for now, and you will learn about them when you do level 2 of the CFA program. Foreign currency translation adjustments, unrealized gain losses on derivative contracts used for hedging, and certain costs of a company's defined benefit post-retirement plan. So these are items which impact OCI and not the net income. I'll give you a simplistic illustration of how other comprehensive income works. Let's say that at the start of the year, we have this balance sheet. A company has 100 invested in a AFS security and 1,000 invested in property, plant, and equipment. Those are the only assets. There are no liabilities. Equity, therefore, is 1,100. And notice our basic equation balances. Assets equal liabilities plus equity. Liabilities are zero. Over the year, here is the very simple income statement. Revenue 300, expenses 100. So net income is 200. We assume that the entire net income is retained. In other words, no dividends are paid. And the AFS security, which started out at 100, now goes up to 120. So what does the balance sheet look like at the end of the year? Remember, I just mentioned that the increase in value of an AFS security is part of other comprehensive income. This increase of 20 is shown as other comprehensive income. So comprehensive income for the year is equal to the net income, which is 200, that's coming from there, plus other comprehensive income, which is 20. So the comprehensive income is equal to 220. Let's look at the balance sheet. The cash is 200. This is coming from the net income. So that's right there. The AFS security has gone up to 120. So that's shown over here. Assume that the property, plant, and equipment is still at 100,000. And equity has gone up to 1,320. Notice that the increase in equity is 220. So the total comprehensive income shows us how we go from the original equity number of 110,000 to the new equity number of 1,320. The net income, or even the retained net income alone, does not explain the difference between these two numbers. That difference is explained using comprehensive income, which is a combination of net income and other comprehensive income. So to consolidate this concept, let's do the example shown here. At the start of the year, the equity for this company is 2,200,000. We are told that the net income is 1.6 million and the amount paid as a dividend is 800,000. So the retained earnings for the year equal 800,000. The ending shareholder equity is 3.2 million. Now, if you recall, the item that explains the difference between 2.2 million, the starting equity, and the ending equity, 3.2 million, is the comprehensive income. And comprehensive income is made up of net income, or actually the retained earnings, and other comprehensive income. The retained earnings equal 800,000. So we have 2.2 million plus 800,000 plus this OCI is going to give us 3.2 million. So what is OCI? OCI has to be 200,000. So that is the answer to this question. OCI is 200,000. That brings us to the end of this long reading. We will cover the most important points briefly. The first thing we talked about was revenue recognition. This is extremely important, and I will summarize the two most important revenue recognition items. The first is that the product or service has to be delivered, and the second is that we need to be reasonably sure of collecting cash. We then talked about revenue recognition for long-term contracts and for installment sales. Expense recognition, the key point here is the matching principle. Non-recurring items and non-operating items. As an analyst, we need to understand what items will recur in the future, what items will not recur. This helps us make projections. We need to understand how much money is being made from the core operation of a firm versus income that is coming from non-core activities. We need to understand the basic and diluted EPS calculation, so make sure you understand all the examples that we talked about. Common sized income statements and ratio analysis, these are tools that we use to analyze the income statement. We talked about them briefly here. Later, there will be a reading on the analysis of financial statements, which will cover these items in more detail. And finally, we talked about comprehensive income, which is equal to the net income plus OCI. As always, I will encourage you to read the summary in the curriculum, review the learning objectives, go over the examples in the curriculum, do the practice problems, and these are very good but not enough. So also try to do as many practice questions as you can from other sources. That is it.